Hello and welcome to episode 3 of Running Your Stories. Today we're going to have a man on who has just run his very first half marathon. And that is a very crucial time in a lot of people's running career. They're getting in that first half marathon, the first time you get up to that 13.2 mile distance. And we'll hear a little bit about how his running started, how it's progressed. So let's introduce an old friend of mine, Richard Robinson.
Yeah. Right, so welcome, Richard.
Thank you.
As we were saying, I've invited you along to tell your story, your running story, which is what we're all about here. And as well as telling some quite extreme stories that we have, what we're really trying to focus on in this podcast is to keep things down to earth and relatable to different types of people. And as we've been talking, I know that you've recently hit a milestone for yourself in your running, so it seemed like a good time to invite you on and and talk about where your running started, why you started running, and take it from there.
Yeah, okay. So, was that a cue for me to... I started running probably about two and a half years ago. So I started really just to get fit and to lose a bit of weight. I was doing a job which was very kind of demanding time wise, a lot of commuting and stuff, and just started to get put on weight, walking up a flight of stairs out of breath. So I really started just doing going out at night time, doing a bit of running here. So then it just kind of slowly built up. I kind of got into it a little bit more and slowly built up. And as I say, I did a half marathon 2 weeks ago. So, which is my first milestone, I guess, or first real race I've done. So, which is, well, so that's kind of a very short version of.
Yeah. So, as you say, you did your first half marathon, which is fantastic. And I know sort of when I came back into running last year, I remember, although it was technically my fourth half marathon, it was kind of like my first of my new running, and it is a big challenge. What I also remember, of course, is you and I having some very entertaining drinking sessions together.
And we don't know what you mean.
Because we did used to work together and went out for business meals and entertaining and things like that. And I know you did used to enjoy that part of the lifestyle. I was just wondering how, because getting fit is obviously a great aim and something that would encourage people to do, but do you feel any loss moving away from that sort of lifestyle?
No, not at all really. It's like I don't really tend to drink much anymore, being down to it's like all the exercise and stuff or running stuff, but it's like I guess my life's just moved on a little bit, but no, I don't miss it at all. Particularly, I mean, I still drink occasionally or go out. I mean, it's but just a lot more in moderation, I guess, now than before, or less regularly than before.
Yeah, I mean, it's very similar for myself as well, actually. As we remember, may have been a few pints and then a bottle of gin in a pub on a night, and now I'm more like maybe a bottle of gin a month kind of. Yeah. There's no need to stop drinking because you're getting fit. You can still enjoy having a drink, but it's certainly I don't miss those morning afters and try to work out how you're going to cope with life after.
Make me sound like an alcoholic.
Well, it's more really thinking about the fact that actually, you know, we had great times together and drinking and stuff like that. And I think some people have some concern about kind of thinking they're going to turn into like a fitness freak and you can't ever do that again. And
I mean, it's not so much the thing, but it's more the food side as well. I mean, when my intention was to lose weight, but I didn't start just going stop eating or eating salad because I just know I'd never maintain that. So I do like to go out, I do like to eat, but I just kind of be a lot more careful on what I actually did. And actually what helped me was one of the smart trackers and using the app, and I just counted calories just for about 3 weeks until I got an idea of what I was consuming versus what I was burning. Then that just helped me work out really what was what I could actually intake to either burn weight or maintain my weight. So nothing, that's not rocket science. It's just being a bit more sensible. So just ordering a little bit less food, cooking a little bit less. I don't eat the kids' food when they don't finish it at tea time and stuff like that. You know? So it all kind of helped. So it wasn't particularly difficult, I would say. It's just the lifestyle's changed a little bit due to this and also other life circumstances. But yeah, it's a...
I mean, what you're saying there about how much you eat and things, I approached it in a very similar way, but slightly different. In I read a very good book which talked about diet quality rather than focusing on calories. You actually score up the quality of what you've eaten in a day. And so if you're eating, let's say something like fried chips, French fries, as the Americans would call it, you're going to get a negative score for that food item, whereas when you eat some good healthy fruit and things like that, you get a positive score.
Yeah.
And it's an interesting way of doing it, because the calorie counting can become psychologically quite a negative thing, where you start to have it sounds like you've done it very, very well, counting the calories for a period of time to get the understanding, and then just working on the kind of the feeling of the portion sizes and things like that, I think's an excellent way to go. The diet quality score is a similar idea, because that actually scores on portions, but how big your portion is up to you, because we're all different sizes.
Yeah.
And eat different amounts. You know, so a 5'1" lady who's doing very little exercise doesn't need to eat as much as I might eat now at 6'2", training for ultra marathons. I eat quite a lot.
Yeah, imagine.
but the quality of what you eat actually is a lot of the key to it.
Yeah.
And it's, again, like you're saying, you knew you couldn't stick to sort of a rigid diet or a particular sort of count of calories long term, and it just wouldn't work out. And again, that's where this diet quality scoring can help, because it just slowly gets you around to the mindset of you eat food for nutrition, and if something has no nutritional value, try and avoid eating it.
Yeah.
And it actually, I found it kept me interested, because I'd go to the kitchen for a biscuit or something like that, and then think, well, hold on, if I eat a biscuit, it's a negative score, but if I eat that piece of fruit, it's a positive score. And it just helped me make a better choice more times, and the more times you do it, becomes a habit, and then it becomes easy. I think exactly as you've described, trying to find a way that works for you that can become a habit is really
a biscuit. They just don't get the whole packet.
Exactly. Yeah, I still eat biscuits as well. Yeah. Actually, one of the things I tried to do, which was put across in this book very well, is because it talked about examples of people like Tour de France winners and things like that. And I'm not very good at remembering the names, but one of the examples it uses is a guy who does like 100-mile bike ride as a sort of training thing. Halfway through it, he stops and has a bottle of Coke, because he likes to drink Coke. Mm. And generally, drinking Coke's really not very good for you, because there's a lot of sugar in it. But in the middle of a massive piece of exercise, all that sugar, you just burn it off instantly. It's really not going to do you any harm at all. And it therefore doesn't actually get a negative score on the diet quality score. And so that's like I say, it's an interesting way of doing it as well, but it's the same overall effect. You just try to get yourself into good habits and stick with those good in a sustainable way.
Yeah,
and that's where I see a lot of people going wrong, trying to have kind of a strict diet or this diet or that diet. It needs to work for you.
So
how much weight did you lose?
I think for my peak, which is before I started exercising, I guess, a little bit before that, about 30 kilograms, I guess, which is about 4.5 stone, something like that. So it was quite a bit of age. I'm quite tall, like yes, I didn't really tend to notice it too much, but if you look at pictures now and like before, it's a is quite noticeable, and suddenly now I've got to go and buy a whole lot of new clothes as well. So, but yeah, so about 30 kilograms, so which is quite a bit, really, when you would think that's about 30 bags of sugar or something. So,
yeah, I think you're in a similar situation to me. I'd got to the point where I was going to have to buy new trousers because I couldn't any longer wear the same ones because they were too small for me. And now I'm at the point where I have to buy new trousers because they're too big for me and they just fall down.
Yeah, it's the same.
Yeah. So I think we both get criticised by my wife for our trousers being too baggy.
Yeah. Not that much before, so it's quite a refreshing change. So.
Exactly. Yeah, it's definitely a refreshing change to be talking about things being too baggy. It was interesting. I was going to a race event recently, and one of my friends said, "Oh, you can tell the people that aren't serious runners because either their kit's hanging off them because it doesn't fit properly, or their kit's brand new."
Yeah.
I said to them, "Well, actually, I fall into that category. So if I wear any of my old kit, it's hanging off me because I've lost so much weight, and the stuff that fits me properly is all brand new."
Yeah.
It's a better way around to be.
Yeah, it is. I mean, I'm actually enjoying it as well. So it's not been particularly hard work, and as you get into it, you get more motivated and stuff as well, which is what happened to me at least. And I don't know, it just felt it's a good release. It's good to excuse to get out of the house and go outside and do some marine and stuff. And I really quite enjoy it now. And so getting past that first 5K, I think for me was the toughest part. I remember doing park run a few a while ago and stuff. I can't remember where it was now. It was on your birthday, I think. I can't remember where that was, but
Halifax.
That was one, yeah. That was a bit hilly, that one. But yeah, it's really struggle on that one. But now, I mean,
I forgot about that. Yeah, because I think were you over 30 minutes at that time on Halifax park run.
Yeah, 30 something. But that was a few in. I think before that was around about 40 minutes or 40+ minutes and. Barely breathing when I got to the end, but now I think I'm down, well, not super fast, but I'm say I think about 22, 23 minutes, which for me is pretty good. So, I'm happy with
it's
that.
It's definitely a very respectable time. I kind of the mindset that there's these really kind of athletes, basically, whether they're professional or just the very focused lifestyle, and also have the body made for that kind of distance and speed. You know, they're down in the sub 18 minute kind of category, and then there's the ordinary people where if you get anywhere near the 20 minute mark, you're doing really, really well, and you should be really, really proud of yourself. Up to where the high 20s, I think, is very kind of it's people that are running regularly, they're doing well, and like you say, enjoying it.
Yeah, that's what it's about. So I'm not doing it to compete particularly. I'm just doing it for my own. I'm kind of racing against myself at the moment. I want to kind of push things a little bit. But yeah, it's been good. Van Parken's been really helpful, actually. That was it's a bit of a community there and stuff. And it's quite good to go up there. And it keeps me going out as well. So
yeah, absolutely. I mean, now that I'm into ultra distance things now, but I still like to go back to parkrun. And only 3 weeks ago, I got my 50th parkrun at last.
T-shirt now, so.
Yeah, I'm just waiting for them to print some new t-shirts.
50th ultra then, yeah. So what do you get for that? So.
I think you get committed to a mental asylum for your 50th ultra. Yeah.
A new leg or something.
So how did you find your first half marathon, because that's a big step up of getting up to the 5K mark.
Yeah, it is. And actually, I was going up to it, I was kind of a little bit excited, kind of nervous at the same time. I wasn't sure we'd be able to do it properly, but actually I really enjoyed the whole thing. I was quite surprised, and it was a relatively flat course, but it just so many people there, it just kind of kept it going. So I actually did a reasonable time as well on that, from what my expectations were. But I think I enjoyed the whole course, actually. It was really good, so I'm quite looking forward to my next one now. So I'm going to sign up for another one coming up. Well, I'm not sure which one yet, but there's a couple coming up soon, so I'm going to sign up for that and just try and keep it going a little bit. So
I think you trained well for that, haven't you?
Yeah, I use a app for that on a phone, which kind of did a training plan. So I did try and follow it up and just around a little bit. But I found that quite helpful just to kind of get the distance up. And so I actually ran a couple of halves on training just before that, just to make sure I could do the distance. And where I train normally is a lot of unavoidable hills, I guess, which helped a little bit, especially because this one's on a flat course. But yeah, I did train, but I try and go out three, four times a week, but more just for, I guess, for enjoyment and just to get out of the house as well as anything else. So it's, you call it training, but it's more kind of just fun as well and just kind of way of just getting out, really.
So. Yeah. So when you go out on your training runs, are you doing anything specific? Do you have fast ones or slower runs? Or
Not a little bit. But I tend to just a distance, I guess. I sometimes depend on how much time I have. Something like do short ones or longer ones. But I do try and push the speed a little bit. But that's one thing I'm not particularly good at the moment is kind of pacing and stuff like that. So maybe I'll try and work on that next.
Yeah.
Also, just my course a little bit from where I live. Sometimes I'll stick to the roads, or sometimes I'll go off country and go up the hills a bit and try and add more hills in. But I do try and add hills in where I can. I used to hate hills when I first started, but now not quite as much as you, but I just quite like hills a little bit now. So
yeah, I mean, hills, actually, I was given some very, very good advice last year by he's one of the personal trainers at the gym I go to, a guy called Simon Courtney. I'll give him some extra thanks for it, because it is very helpful and it helped me a lot. That, similar to yourself, I used to hate hills, used to really struggle going up hills. And there's two basic ways. Well, there's only one way to get good at hills, and that's to run hills.
Mm.
But there's two methods to really advance yourself on hills. One is doing short, steep hills, and the other is doing long, steady hills, where you can sustain that higher work rate all the way up the hill. And I think it depends a little about exactly what you're trying to achieve. Now, because I was, even at that time, focused on doing the longer distance things, Simon recommended I went for the long, steady hills. And so not far from where I live, there's a hill, I'm not sure exactly how long it is, 500-600 metres, just fairly steady gradient. And I run up the hill, run basically around the block and up the hill again, and around the block and up the hill again, and do hill reps that way, which is quite different to doing hill reps. There's a local reservoir nearby here, Scammonden Dam, and it's about 6 or 8 flights of steps, and they are steps about the same steepness as steps in your house, and you run up that, and it's very different kind of hill reps doing those hill reps to doing the long steady ones. I found the long steady ones really just repeating that hill, and while you're kind of running around the block to get back to the bottom, you're just trying to get your breathing right, you know, sort of get your blood circulating and everything again, and you push yourself up the hill and then relax as you come around. That really helps get you working for hills.
I might try that or not. I just don't like repetitive loops, so that's
it. No, I know, but to be honest, I try to do things like that about once a fortnight for me, because I also don't like the repetitiveness of it. Another friend of ours who's also going to be talking on the podcast at some point, Kim, she does her hill reps religiously once a week on the same day of the week at about 5 in the morning. And, you know, some people are really that focused and are absolutely sort of fantastic. I'm a bit more relaxed and like a bit more variety. And
so you're making me look bad now.
Well, I mean, it isn't, and this is a really important thing. It's not about anybody looking good or bad,
because
all of this is about the lifestyle that you choose to have, and the choosing a healthy lifestyle is really good. So the other thing I just mentioned to you to look into, because with all these things, I'm not a personal trainer. I'm just sharing my own experiences. But there's there's an 80-20 rule with training. If you want to do the kind of the most efficient training, you should only run 20% of your runs above 80% heart rate.
Right, okay.
So what most people do is go out and run all of their runs at about the same kind of speed, which is probably going to be about 60 to 70% heart rate. And you will get better, but you'll probably plateau. And the way to break that plateau is actually most of your runs, do them at a comfortable conversation pace. Mm. So if you're just doing it based on sort of feeling, it's sort of below 60% of your maximum heart rate. It's the technical thing, but it's about perceived effort. So if you're doing it at kind of low perceived effort, which means you can just kind of jog along and have a chat and it's feeling good. If you do 80% of your runs or 80% of the time you're running, because you can mix it up within the same run as well, like that, and then do the 20% at a really high, you know, pushing yourself rate, you'll actually get fit faster.
Oh, okay.
With less effort, because most of your run, you're just enjoying yourself. Now, sometimes I also like to just enjoy myself by just allowing myself to run at any old pace, rather than trying to work on this or work on that. So, you know, again, I wouldn't knock people for having runs the way you just go out and enjoy yourself, just do a run.
But, yeah, I might give that a go. So I guess that's where I am now. I'm kind of plateauing a little bit in terms of the speed. But yeah.
But it's an interesting thing. And again, there's a lot of information around and personal trainers will be able to help you more precisely with that. But it really advances your fitness a lot. And a good example is like when I do parkrun now, I live about 4K from parkrun. So I have a nice gentle 4K downhill run, which I try to force myself to go slow on. And then I absolutely thrash myself around the 5K on parkrun, where, you know, I couldn't possibly maintain that pace for longer than 5K. And then I go a nice slow run back up the hill to get home.
Yeah.
And it's only really that 5K a week where I look at pushing myself to my maximum pace, and then the odd run like I did last night when I was running with other people, you kind of get forced to run at an uncomfortable pace at times because they're faster, and at other times you're waiting for people, and again it mixes it up a bit, but yeah, my long runs, I'm generally trying to keep the effort down. It's surprising, your body thanks you for it, because your recovery from that's faster, so therefore you can run more.
Yeah. Well, I'm seeing the half as a long run, so I'm not sure you're doing ultra.
Well, actually, part of the secret of ultra running, and maybe, you know, I don't know if we can say this on camera, is you walk quite a bit of it.
I figured you might be able to. Yeah. When I saw your video in the start, I thought you were going to all sprint off, but you were kind of walking. It's not the most dramatic start I've ever seen, but...
Yeah, I mean, it is about pacing, and that's the thing, that you know, you run at a very different pace. If you're going to try and sustain it for hour after hour after hour, you've got to be basically operating well within yourself, rather than pushing yourself. So
yeah.
So you mentioned to me beforehand as well about not only the physical benefits, but actually you just said feel happier.
I also use it as a way of kind of burning off stress and stuff as well before, and it's like just being physically fitter, I guess, and going out and spending that time, I guess, just out running, I just feel a lot more less stressed and stuff now, and can just generally feel happier, and I think that's a combination of both the running but also just being fitter as well. And so yeah, it's been good for the mind as well, which has been great. So,
Has your family noticed the difference?
I like to think so. Yeah, I think so. I mean, I need to get them out now. Yeah.
I know my family has. That's why I asked that question.
But,
as you say, the other thing that I've noticed recently, you've probably seen this as well, is how green is it outside right now?
Yeah, it's great. Yeah, it's
And I just think of how many years I was just commuting and in the car, and you just miss that.
You see the grey through the windscreen of all the houses and stuff, yeah. You know, you get out in the hills and stuff, and it's...
Maybe it's because it's been so wet recently, and then suddenly had actually some warm weather. Yeah. I think it's just fantastic.
Yeah. It's good now. It wasn't good when it was all that wet weather came, though. It's running through a swamp for some of it, and stick to the road. So.
Yeah, you see, you need a little... We need to encourage you to get off-road a bit more. Yeah, that'll come, that'll come.
Yeah, it just takes a bit longer to find somewhere off-road, doesn't it? So,
yes, I mean, it does, actually. Especially when you first start getting off-road, you can get very focused on trying to find really kind of pristine tracks and great pieces of off-road running, which there are a lot more around than you might think. But I've found by entering local events that are doing off-road tracks, including recently, three of us went along to, there was a walk with Friends of the Peak District.
Okay.
The Magnificent 20, as they called it. And it would be a really nice 20-mile walk, so we went along and ran it. They were asking us, actually, you know, why would you want to come along and run something like that? And the reason is that we wanted to do a training run of that kind of distance on that day. But because it's an organised walk, there were points along the way where you could get water if we needed it.
Yeah.
And somebody had an idea where we were, and it was somebody else's route. And that means that you go onto tracks that you wouldn't have gone on before, and suddenly you discover, oh, there's a really nice track here. I didn't know this was here, because it's quite surprising, it surprises me at least, how many tracks there are that you would just never think about going on to.
Yeah.
And so by going along onto different events, ones, you know, some that might be quite short. I mean, I took my family along to, there's a local group promoting trail running, they're doing baby trails, that they call it in this area. And I took my wife and kids along to that recently. And okay, for me, it might have been quite easy. It was a really nice day. Lovely to get out with the family. Absolutely superb. And also discovered a couple of tracks I didn't know existed as well. You know, it's nice that I find getting out on some kind of randomish local events. And you'll discover tracks. And then you start to piece things together. Part of my sort of recent recovery and getting back to things was I wanted to get back up to marathon distance. And I managed to piece together a trail route. I probably only had to run 500 or 600 meters on tarmac from my house before I got onto the trails. And then I think I had one road on the way back, which I've since learned a trail variant of. So I wouldn't need that road again, and did 26.2 miles from my house. Well, it was 26 and a half miles loop, almost completely on trail, straight from my door. It just takes time.
Yeah. I might try and search out some trails. I do a little bit, but it tends to be quiet road stuff I tend to do. I do go off up hills and stuff, but not as much as you, at least. So.
Yeah, you'll find as well, if you start running on trails, that hurts your legs a lot less. Yeah. A lot less. And you have an excuse to buy some more shoes.
There's enough shoes in our house. We're not all mine.
Yeah, I'm getting to the point where soon I'm going to own the most shoes in my house, which...
I'm not sure that's a good day.
No, I'm not sure it's a good thing. So, did you see how long ago you started getting into running?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it's about 2.5 years, I think. Okay, so although it's started and stopped and started again, so we kind of stopped because we moved back into England, and also we rent a house. Renovations and stuff basically took over, so and that's when I started doing 5Ks again. That's when I kind of realized I had back to the almost square one again. So a couple of years, I guess, in total. So
So a couple of years, negative side, you've lost weight, feel happier, better lifestyle. Positive side, you don't drink so much.
I never drank that much in the first place, but apart from occasion, but yeah. So, But yeah, overall it's been good. I mean, so I'm glad I'm still doing it. So if it wasn't us, I guess I still wouldn't be doing it. So I'm not sure if my goals are the same quite as yours as hitting ultras and stuff, but so I'm quite happy with the half at the moment. So I might try and do a full later on the year just to see if I can do one, but I'll start training for that maybe soon. So signed up for Tough Mudder as well, which I think talking to is probably a bit of a crazy idea, but anyway,
I don't know. To be honest, I can see why people are attracted to things.
It looks like fun. Yeah,
I mean, so. Because I end up on trails where I'm basically doing those things because they just happen to be in front of me, including electric fences.
Yeah, I didn't know there was like fences when I signed up. Yeah. So I thought it'd be just a good way to do a train as well. I mean, so I started training for the half, so I was doing a lot of running, so by doing other things it would be just hopefully motivate me to do other training as well. So
I personally think it's well worth mixing up the training. It can start to get repetitive and your body becomes very focused on just one discipline. So I've got a bit of mountaineering coming up in July, and I need to get back to swimming. It's starting to warm up now, get outside swimming again. Yeah. Things like that. So yeah, that's definitely a good idea to just throw some different kind of events in there.
Yeah, well, you're doing a triathlon next.
I'm disappointingly slow on the bike and swimming. Yeah. I enjoy both, but I think I would just be so upset with myself when I might be competitive on the run and then be at the very, very back on the bike and the swim. But it'll happen at some time.
Yeah. You sure will.
At some point. Yeah. Maybe we should do it together.
Yeah.
There's some good, I think they get called sprint triathlons, which for me doesn't mean you have to go faster. What it means is the shorter distances.
Right, okay.
I know of one locally in home Firth, which is a sprint triathlon. So there are some of the shorter triathlons around, so you don't have to commit yourself to the... It's particularly the swim where I would struggle with the distance. Or just get so far behind everybody else.
It's just the getting wet bit in the swim, is it?
Yeah.
I can't do triathlon. My brother does those. There's no way I can keep up with him, so I have to say.
It's good to mix it up. So I think that's probably covered what we were looking at today. It's great to have a chat with you and just talk about how running's affected your life, really.
It's been good. So I'll keep doing it. So
yeah, and we'll maybe get you back on after you've done your first marathon.
I'll maybe try and do one later this year. I think there's one I'm looking at in October. Is it October? Yeah, somewhere around there. So it gives me enough time to train for it. So it's getting the time to do training for a full
one. Once you've done that one in October, I can recommend a very nice one in January, which is a night marathon in January.
It sounds interesting.
It looks really, really good. And I was on an event by the same organisers recently. It'll be well organised.
I might take a look at that. Sounds quite good.
This is a thing that I've really had my eyes opened since I sort of pretty much ran on my own to get up to a level that I was happy with, and then started doing events and meeting other people. And suddenly, there's just hundreds of events happening all the time. And I'm slightly overwhelmed with trying to choose which events to do because I can't do them all. And there's such fantastic events around. I think pretty much any type of event you want to find in any area of the country at whatever time of the year, you'll be able to find it. There's some great stuff around.
I'll keep it tamed down a little bit for now, but I do feel like it's going to get a little bit addicted though. So I really enjoyed that first half marathon. I'm not sure why, but it was good. So I'm quite looking forward to the next one now. I'll do another one fairly soon, hopefully. So I wanted to train too hard for that because I can only do it, so it'd be good.
Yeah.
Just got to try and beat my own time there.
That's right. Best of luck with
that.
And until next time.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks for coming along and sharing your story.